Welcome to the Carl Nelson Show
on Washington, D.C.'s 1450 WOL Radio and live around the world on WOLDCNews.com.
Thank you for staying with us, folks. And, of course, you can always reach us on Facebook and Twitter at CarlNelsonShow.com. Our guest is Neely Fuller, Jr. Neely Fuller, Jr., welcome back to WOL.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
You know, we just finished having a conversation with a reporter out of Jackson, Mississippi, and he did a piece called The Fate of Hate, the story of James Craig Anderson, a young black man who was run over in, by a truck driven by some white teenagers. And he was saying that, the people just don't want to talk about the racism that was involved. He couldn't get anybody to have the discussion about racism, especially in Jackson, Mississippi. And he said the people there were trying to tell him what it's like being in the South. But is there a reason why we don't want to talk about this issue?
Well, people are tired of it, for one thing. It's been around like forever. And so people just say, well, it's going to be around, and that's sort of a resignation to it. When you talk to people about racism, they just simply have that tired look. I mean, they say, okay, here we go again. I mean, can't we talk about something else? You can almost see it in people's eyes. They just, what's the point in talking about it? Some years ago, I was talking to a gentleman, and he said, look here, the race problem cannot be solved. It can only be discussed. And then I thought about that statement, because it could be true, but then I thought about, well, the logic of it. If you have a problem that can't be solved, that is impossible to solve, and they say all you can do is discuss it, but you can't solve it, it's no point in discussing a problem that can't be solved. That's logic. And I always say that you go with logic, because logic came with the universe. So why even mention a problem that can't be solved? Why even talk about it? Why put it in the newspapers? If it's impossible to solve, it's just impossible to solve. And everybody will understand that and let it go at that. Now, I'm one of those people who happen to believe that a problem that is made by people can be solved by people. If it's made by some other entity, like the creator of the universe or something like that, then that's a different story. But a problem that is made by people can be solved by people. I believe that. The race problem is an invention of people. People invented it, just like you invent a deck of playing cards. And so, therefore, you can talk about a problem that can't be solved, because that's the first thing that you do, but you want to do some thinking before you talk. That's why the subtitle of my book is a textbook workbook for thought, speech, and or action for victims of racism, meaning you think about the problem first. And what do you think when you think about a problem? You think about solving it, if it's a problem. And in order to solve any problem, you think about cause and effect. And the first step towards solving any problem in the universe, theoretically, according to logic, the way I see it, is to put it in the form of a question. First of all, what is the problem? What is causing the problem? Why does the problem exist? And then you, last but not least, look at how the problem was made, how it's all put together. Because the way that it was put together is the way that you will take it apart. And the system of racism is put together by deception and violence. So the first thing you want to know is, where is the deceit? How are people being fooled? How are people being played, as they say? So you look for everything, all of the ingredients that go into deceiving people, getting people to do things through deception. Because if you can deceive people, you can control them. Because when you deceive people, you're basically confusing them. And any confused people can be controlled by someone who's not confused. That's the mathematics. That's the logic. So we look and see how people have been deceived collectively, and then you begin to, like, you reveal anything when there's deception going on, and you reveal the deception. You have just about taken care of most of the problem right there. Anytime people are being fooled, and then you come along with truth, and you say exactly how something is put together, how people are being deceived, and all like that, and then people, well, naturally, that's just a natural reaction, that you react to what you know to be true. All people do this. You will react to what you know to be true. Prior to that, if you're confused, you will just react to the confusion. And that just makes for more confusion if you don't deconfuse the situation. If the person doesn't become deconfused, then the person is just going to continue to be confused, and all of his or her actions are going to reflect that. So that would cover the system of racism, as you just said, about it's just another racial incident, you might say, but as racial incidents happen all over the planet each and every minute, each and every second of the day. Why? Because we are in an entire system of racism. So racism is always prevalent. It's just some things that stand out more than others.
Well, tell us how we're being deceived. Let's start there.
Oh, we're being deceived by, first of all, just by people saying they're tired of being talking about racism. Let's talk about something else. It isn't anything else to talk about. If you're going to talk about something else, you're going to be talking about racism. But you're deceived to the extent that you don't know that you're talking about racism. Because most of the things that people talk about are problems. People, you know, in looking for some type of way to be joyous, and everybody's looking to be happy, the pursuit of happiness just goes on and on and on. But in order to be happy, you have to eliminate a lot of hurt, a lot of pain. So pain comes in the form of problems. So everybody has problems. People will talk about their problems. But when you start trying to talk about solving a problem without talking about racism, you're not really talking about solving the problem. Now, that's what people have to be aware of, because that's what people have been deceived into believing, that there are other problems out here that you can solve, and you can't be bothered with racism because you got to solve these other problems. But what they can't see, because of the deception and because the racists have been very deceptive in that to perfection, they're perfectionists when it comes to deception. They say people will not even recognize racism when they see it. And they will be chasing around trying to solve all these different problems that they say that they have, when the main problem that they have is the problem of racism, which stands in the way of them solving all the other problems they say they got to get to. That's why I have it on the back of the book. No major problem can be solved in any area of activity, economics, education, entertainment, labor, law, politics, religion, sex, and war, unless you address and solve the problem of racism. You're going to keep having all these problems. I don't care what your problem is, if you are classified as non-white and you're on this planet, anywhere on this planet, you better be thinking about solving the problem of racism, or every problem that you have, you're going to continue to have it.
You know, because, you know, a lot of our people who deal extensively with people of other races, and I know they tell me every time there's an issue coming up, they say, oh, you're being racist, or you're being, they always see that the black person always sees things through the racial prism. And white folks claim they're not racist. They say they're not racist. It's, you know, that's how they react to things. How do you decipher if they are being racist or if they're not?
You say the things that I just said. You simply say that people will say, well, you know, like I said before in just this conversation, the problem, if racism exists, it can't be solved anyway, so what's the point in fooling with it? Well, you got to fool with it because it's the only thing on the bill of fare. It's the only show in town. There's no other show in town, period. Racism dominates the planet. It's not a side issue. It's not like you're having a circus and racism is some type of sideshow that you have maybe one day out of a week at the local circus. A lot of people look at it like that, that racism is something you run into every now and then.
Right. Hold that thought right there, Neely Fuller Jr., because we got to take a break for traffic and weather. When we come back, I'll let you finish up. We're speaking with Neely Fuller Jr. His book is called The Code. That's a short name. When we come back, I'll let him tell you the full title of his book. Folks, you can join our conversations, 800-450-7876. We'll take your calls after this quick break.
And now back to the Carl Nelson Show.
On Washington, D.C.'s 1450.
1450 WOL Radio.
And thank you for staying with us, folks. And Neely Fuller Jr., the number to call, speak to Neely Fuller Jr. is 800-450-7876. Discussing, the topic people don't want to talk about, and that's racism. Brother Neely Fuller came on, was speaking to a young man out of Jackson, Mississippi. He's done a story about the fate of hate, and you can look it up online. You can Google The Fate of Hate. It's about James Craig Addison, a young black man ran over in a truck by three white teenagers who used to cruise at night looking for blacks to harass. But he said nobody in Jackson wanted to talk about it, black, white, young, or old. They don't want to talk about racism, and it's not just Jackson, folks. People, as Brother Neely Fuller just said, people saying, here we go again. Talking about racism, and because the feeling is it's old and there's nothing we can do about it. But Brother Neely Fuller, you say there is something that can be done about it?
Yes, well, we have to be systematic and we have to do what works. That's logical. We always follow the logic. I always use that term, follow the logic. Logic came with the universe. So people sometimes ask me, they say, well, if I go on my job talking about racism all the time, black people turn against me and the white people turn against me, and I wind up being isolated, and the next thing you know, I'm out of a job because I'm considered just a troublemaker. Well, I have told people it's all in the words you use. Now, the whole reason for getting rid of racism is to replace it with something better. Otherwise, there would be no reason to get rid of racism. So what would that something better be? Something better than racism would be the one thing that racism prevents, and that is a thing called justice. And what is justice? Well, I made up a definition for it that I think will hold up. It may not, but I think it will. And that is, justice consists of two activities. One, guaranteeing that no person is mistreated. And two, guaranteeing that the person that needs help the most gets the most constructive help. Now, my point is, when you're on a job, you don't have to talk about racism. You always talk about, if you're having a conversation with people, the best way to have a conversation with anyone is to talk about the thing that the person wants to talk about. So if people don't want to talk about racism, then you just look at the other side of the page and talk about justice, because the whole purpose for getting rid of racism is to replace it with justice. So you can go directly to a conversation about justice, because the racism is going to take care of that anyway. The racism, if you're looking for justice, you're going to have to deal with racism anyway, because racism is the biggest obstacle to the production of justice. So if you talk about guaranteeing that nobody's mistreated, and guaranteeing that the person that needs help the most, and you do this on the job, and they'll say, well, what are you talking about? You say, I'm talking about a thing called justice. They say, oh, well, we thought you were going to talk about racism. Well, you are talking about racism, but they didn't want to use that word. So you say, okay, what about talking about justice? Very simple. You don't want to talk about racism? Okay, we won't talk about racism, because that'll make everybody nervous, okay? I didn't come here to make everybody nervous. I'm trying to solve a problem. You say you have a problem? What's the problem? The problem has to do with somebody being mistreated or somebody not getting what they deserve to get in a constructive manner. That's what justice is about. So we go straight to the juggler, you might say. Justice itself, the product that you're really after. Not just what you're trying to get rid of, but what you're trying to replace it with. So you're trying to replace a system of racism with a system of justice. which means guaranteeing that no person is mistreated. And you can say that on your job without looking over your shoulder. Ladies and gentlemen, we're having this meeting here about what we're here for. Well, one thing we're here for is to guarantee that no person is mistreated. That's number one. And to guarantee that the person that needs help the most gets the most constructive help. Do I have any dissenters? Do I have anybody who's opposed to this thing called justice being produced in this work facility? Let him or her speak now or forever hold his or her peace. Do I get an amen? And then that's the way you go with it. And the average person sitting around a conference table, it's been my experience, nobody ever held up their hand and say, well, I'm against this thing called justice. I am against justice. You can put me down as being against justice. Well, if you're against justice, maybe you shouldn't be working here, because everybody on every job throughout the world most likely will hold up their hand and say that they're for justice. So you're not going to get any dissenters on that. But if you start talking about racism, people are going to leave the room or look at the sky, or look down at the table, or crawl under the table, or look at you with hostility, might even ask that, you know, that you leave because you're stirring up trouble. So you do the things that will work, and at the same time still be telling the truth and still be solving the problem that you came to solve. You're not dodging the problem. You're just using different words, codified language. The white supremacists are experts at using codified language. They practice racism all day long and do it with a smile. And everybody's nodding and going along with it because they pretty it all up in a nice package in the way that they use words. They'll call racism freedom. And then ask, is anybody against freedom? And nobody holds up their hand. But they'll actually be practicing racism, because what they mean is, I want freedom to mistreat you. I want freedom to deny what you should have. See, they'll say freedom, but they don't say what for. Freedom to do what? See, we have to think about the use of words.
Neely Fuller Jr., how do we get people to understand, to get to that level, though? Because most people, they're afraid to even broach the subject of racism, even in the form that you say of justice. Because they go again.
Well, just don't mention racism at all. And see, if somebody else on a job situation, you can mention racism when somebody else mentions it, particularly to somebody else who's supposed to be in charge. And they'll get around to it, because all roads lead to racism anyway. I don't care what you start off talking about. You're going to wind up talking about racism. You see people do it on television all the time. They'll start off talking about one thing, and about halfway through the program, they wind up talking about racism in a very nervous way. And if you notice something else, people get nervous. Black people get nervous. White people get nervous here in 2013 when you start talking about racism. Now, what happens as a result of the nervousness? Everybody starts making jokes. It goes one way or the other. Either everybody gets real hostile, and in this day and time, most people don't want to do that. Not if they're sitting around trying to solve a problem and in an amiable way and trying to get along with each other. So if you get black people and white people are talking about racism, everything gets uptight real fast, and it's going either one way or another. Either it's going to get more and more hostile, or everybody's going to start joking about it. Either way, the problem doesn't get solved, because you cannot solve a problem when everybody's being hostile and starts name-calling and all like that. So if you decide to go the other way and just make a joke out of racism, and everybody starts finding an excuse to laugh, one person starts laughing, and all around the table, the next thing you know, in about 5 minutes, everybody's laughing and making jokes. And then it's all downhill there, because that's not solving anything either, because racism is not a joke. But you have to do it in a logical, civil, methodical manner. And keep in mind what your goal is, to replace it with a system of justice. See, if you don't have a goal for getting rid of racism, you're just going to have that argument. And a lot of what you might just, everybody leaves the conference table with a lot of hard feelings. Or everybody's going to leave there laughing, nervously, having made a joke out of the whole matter without it being a joke. Anybody who has observed this knows this is true. I always say it, part of the codification that I talk about in my book is don't ever take anybody's word for anything when you're talking about racism. I don't care who it is. Test it. Test everything. Test everything that Neely Fuller ever says or anybody else ever says. Put it to an acid test. I mean, the strongest test you can put on it.
All right. Hang on a second. We'll take a break. When we come back, some folks want to talk to you. Folks, you can join the conversation with Neely Fuller Jr. It's real easy. It's 800-450-7876. We'll take your phone calls right after this quick break. And thank you for staying with us, folks. And our guest, Neely Fuller Jr., the number to call to speak to him is 800-450-7876. Let's go to line two. Robert's joining us from Tennessee. Robert, you're on with Neely Fuller Jr.
Hey, how you doing, Carl and Mr. Fuller?
Yes, sir.
Mrs. Frances Kress Welsler, I can't remember how to pronounce her name. I'm sure you know who I'm talking about. She says, most of the time she comes on Carl's show, she'll say that the reason why these people that we refer to as white supremacists, the reason why they do what they do is because of fear of a genetic annihilation, which I have a different opinion about that. And my opinion is this. I mean, if you look at the white rhino and elephant over in Africa, these two creatures have been fought almost to the brink of extinction, besides the ones who live on reservations. And the elephant or the white rhino in Africa, they don't represent a threat to the genetic survival of these people who we refer to as being white supremacists, but yet they've been put to almost to the same condition as the Indian here in America. So my opinion is that it's not about them being fear of genetically annihilated. It's about them being in control. And the only way you can control a people is to keep them deceived about who they are. I mean, you know, even in the Garden of Eden, Satan wanted to be like God. So God is about light. So these people who we were talking about, they want to control all the land and all the resources on the land, including the people on the land. And the only way that they can control the resources and all the people on the land is keeping the people deceived about who they are. And just to give you a small example, I'm sure you've seen documentaries where these Europeans have come amongst these primitive people living in South America or Africa. Next thing you know, Dr. Fuller, these people are wearing these European people's clothing. You know, where they live at is 80 degrees year round, and they're wearing these European people's clothing. So what you see when you see these people wearing these European people's clothing, that's a microscopic view of a bigger picture. What's going on is he's starting to control how these people think, and that's what his objective is. If he can control how these people think, and then he eventually ends up taking all their land. I mean, I don't know if you see what I'm saying here.
So what is your conclusion?
I guess
were you looking for an answer from me?
Well, what I'm saying is I don't believe that it's about hate coming from them. It's about being in control. That's their objective is to be in control. And like I said before, in order to control somebody, you have to control how they think. And that's the reason why, you know, in places like Chicago, you have teenagers that are killing each other, 500 murders going on every year, is because it's it's all a mind. It's all about controlling how people think, and they've done us. And since they control the airwaves, they control the newspaper, the media, they control the airwaves, they have almost a complete lock on people's way of thinking. And I just wanted to get your opinion of that.
Oh, well, my opinion is they're doing what they're doing. Now, why they are doing it, I have never delved right into that. And I say that the procedure that I would use if I was talking to a white person is just look at whatever it is they are doing. And if they're doing something harmful or doing something constructive, just whatever they're doing, particularly if I have a complaint, the logical question, I try to follow the logic. I ask the people who are doing what they're doing why they are doing it. And then I listen and see if they're going to try to deceive me in giving their answer, because that's the thing I'll be looking for, whether or not they give a deceptive answer. Now, they may just tell the truth. I don't expect that to happen. If it's a white person who I think is practicing racism, and I'm going to ask the question of why are you practicing racism? Why are you mistreating people? Racism means you're mistreating people based on color. Why are you doing this? Ask the person who's doing it. See, now you can get different opinions from other people. I might have my opinion. But an excellent start would say, I'm looking at you doing what you're doing. And not only are you doing it, but you're bragging about doing it. You put it in your history books and all like that. So you're doing it. I mean, you're a slave master. Say, if I'm a slave and I'm talking to the slave master and we want to have an honest conversation, I just simply ask the slave master, why are you a slave master? And that I am a servant to that slave master. That I am a slave to the master. Why have you made me your slave? And please tell me the truth. Now, they may not tell me the truth, but then I would expect that. But then maybe I could ask someone else, maybe another slave, and maybe that slave would know, would be able to see something that I don't see. But I'm saying all problems are solved by the process of questions and answers. That's every problem in the universe. If you ask enough people enough questions and you get enough answers, and then you go around and try to see symptoms of what you're talking about, whatever the questions and answers are, the truth at some point will jump out at you. It'll literally jump out at you, so that you don't really have to ask anybody anything. But you have to initially, if you're confused, ask everybody that you can possibly get to answer a question and get everybody's opinion. Because no one has ever solved the race problem. It's never been done. I mean, people trying to scratch back in history and all like that. In the 1970s, they had black people chasing around trying to find out what we call find out who we are. That was usually the expression used. Without anybody going into detail of what are you looking for to find out who you are for? You are a victim of white supremacy. Now, you want to find out how you got to be that way? Now, that's the kind of history you should be looking for, because I always say when you study history, you should most of all be looking for the mistakes that were made that culminated in you being in the shape that you're in now. That's the main reason for studying history. But the white supremacists had black people for the last 20 years studying black history so that we could brag about ourselves, which they don't mind us doing. They say, you're a bunch of slaves. You're right under my foot. I got my foot on your neck. And what you want to do is brag about yourself and your ancestors? Go right ahead. I have no problem. Just march up and down the street and brag all you want to, as long as you are under my foot while you're bragging, and that you're not going to get from under my foot, because you will never find anything in history that will tell you how to get from under my foot. Otherwise, you couldn't have gotten under my foot in the first place. All of your ancestors made a huge mistake because I outfoxed them. So you won't learn anything there about how to deal with me, and logic ought to tell you that. And that's a hard pill to swallow. But every general in every army, or every messiah that's worth anything, is a person that faces the truth about being a loser. And black people are losers. And we got to find out how it came about that we lost. Because that's what we complain about. But when people talk to us about it, we find an excuse to start bragging about our condition. Looking around for any little kind of little scraps that we can brag about. Brag about our culture without even being able to describe it. I put it on a blackboard once. I put the two words on the top of the board, black culture. And then I asked a large audience of black people, and I've done this several times, how do you describe black culture? Which means, let's get a definition for it, something that black people do that nobody else does. So give me something. Give me something to put on the board. Give me something to put on this board, please. Finally, after about 10 minutes, somebody feebly said, music. I said, okay, let's examine that.
Black Hold that thought right there, because we're going to take another break. Hold that thought right there. Neely Fuller Jr. is our guest, folks. You can join him in discussing on why people are afraid to discuss racism. They don't want to hear about it. We're talking about our folks. 800-450-7876. Take your calls right after this quick break. And thank you for staying with us, folks. Of course, you can always reach us on Facebook and Twitter at CarlNelsonShow.com. Our guest is Neely Fuller Jr. And, you know, before we take the next call, Brother Neely Fuller Jr., can you tell the folks the title of your book?
The title of the book is called The United Independent Compensatory Code System Concept. Now, that's a basic title. Those words don't mean anything until someone looks in the book, and it will tell what those words mean in the book. But there is a subtitle that gives an idea about what the book is about, because the basic title doesn't give it any idea about what the book is about. The subtitle is A Textbook Workbook for Thought, Speech, and Our Action for Victims of Racism. And, of course, racism is described as white supremacy. There's only one racism because there's only one race, and that's the white race as practiced by the white supremacists. The only people who should even want to be members of a race, if that's what they choose to be, are people who intend to practice racism. Racism serves no purpose at all, except to misuse someone based on color. That's all it's good for. You can join a club or an organization or a union or a lot of things. I mean, you can call it different names. I mean, and if you just want to help somebody do something constructive, you don't need to join a race. No one is born into a race, except the people who have decided that they are going to be racists. And the only purpose for being a racist is to practice racism. And practicing racism means you're going to mistreat someone and dominate someone based on color. That's all it's good for. That's all it ever was good for. The white supremacists established something that they call racism and then called themselves the white race. It didn't take in all white people, by the way, because some white people rejected the idea. But many of them, many millions of them, accepted the idea because they saw that they could get a lot of profit out of it. The profit of what? Dominating, mistreating people based on color. And the idea took off like brush fire. Nobody had thought of that idea before, apparently. And if anybody thought of it, they didn't act on it, because the white supremacists are the only ones who acted on the idea of dominating the entire world based on what color somebody is, and mistreating people 24/7 based on a thing called color, skin color. That's it. And they named it racism. They named it that themselves. And then they practiced that, and then they went around telling everybody else what race they belong to. And they still do this. If you notice, or if you haven't noticed, you can notice it now, it's always the people who believe in racism who's telling other people what race they belong to. People don't know what race they belong to until the white supremacists tell them. They'll say, well, you're a member of this race now. For the next 10 years, you'll be a member of this race. And if I decided to change it 30 years down the road, I will change it. You can't change it. Or if you do change it, you'll change it according to my prescription. But one thing you won't be white. Unless I say you're white. Because I am a white supremacist. And I'm in charge of all of the classifications. I don't care what you call yourself. You won't be recognized as that unless I recognize you as being whatever it is that you say that you are. I'll have to recognize it. I'll have to put my stamp on it of approval. Otherwise, I'll pay no attention to it. And if I don't pay any attention to it, you are not who you say you are. You're what I say you are. Because that's what it means by being a white supremacist. I tell you what you are, not you. But you can go around and tell your other cohorts anything. The people who are at the bottom of the slave ship like you are, you all can argue among yourselves about what you are and play those little games and play with kente cloth and all this and brag about it and whatnot. I'm not paying any attention to it at all. Because I'm going to stomp on all of you anytime I get ready and throw you and your kente cloth overboard anytime I get ready because I'm the captain of the entire ship that's called this world. How about that? And that's what my book is about. Now, my book is also about the victims of racism, what to do about it. Because it's no point in talking about a problem if you don't have any ideas about what to do about it. Otherwise, you're just going around in a big circle, which is what we are kind of prone to do.
All right. 800-450-7876. Go to line 3 and reach out to Gwen. Gwen's in D.C. Gwen, you're on with Neely Fuller, Jr.
Yes. Good afternoon. Well, I get kind of confused with the logic, Dr. Fuller. I follow your logic to a certain point, and then I'm just, I just can't grasp it. Because you're saying that, if I heard you correctly, all man-made problems can be solved. Is that what you said?
Yes, ma'am. If people make a problem, people can solve the problem if they made the problem.
Okay. Then you said no one has ever solved the race problem. Then you also said that black people are losers. So trying to follow your logic, okay, racism is the number one problem on the planet. People of color are 3/4 of the people on the planet, right? So then based on your logic and reasoning, then all people, not just black people, all people who are non-white are losers. And about all of these people, and there are many brilliant-minded people, no one has been able to solve the race problem. And so I get really, really confused because I listen to you, I listen to Dr. Welsing and many, many others, very brilliant-minded people who have thoroughly researched and analyzed the problem. However, I listened to Dr. Welsing one time, and she was talking about a problem as a result of racism that she was dealing with, living in her home. And they wanting, to push her out of her home because they wanted her home. And they built this playground and, the stress and all the other health-related problems related to this problem resulting from racism. Now, this is Dr. Frances Quest Welsing. She is unable, based on what I heard, she is unable to solve this problem. So you were saying that you replace racism with justice. That is the solution to racism. Am I understanding you correctly?
Yes, ma'am, because racism is about non-justice. That's already in place. So if you're going to replace racism, the logical thing that you would want to do, you raise the question, is racism a problem? And then the next question is, what kind of problem? Well, racism is about mistreating people. Well, what do you call mistreating people? You call that a lack of justice. So therefore, you replace racism with justice. That's the equation.
Okay.
But no one has figured out how to do it yet. That's why we still have it.
If you have all the parts of the equation,
yes.
You have the logic, you have the reason, you have the facts, you have the decoding, you have all of that. You have all the information that you need, all the ammunition that you need, based on what I'm hearing from you, based on logic and reasoning, et cetera. You have all of that, but yet the problem still remains. Dr.
Yes.
Frances Kress Welsing is confronted with that problem. She has all the logic, all the reasons. She's written books about it. She's done the research, but yet she's still confronted with the problem. So I'm kind of confused in terms of the how-to part. You gave a scenario about a work situation, and you're having this meeting, and, you know, no one wants to talk about racism because everybody gets upset and whatever, whatever. Okay, so you change the word. You don't use the word racism. You use the word justice, and then you ask the question, well, how many people would be against justice? And no one is opposed to justice. Okay, those are just words. Anybody can say, you know, I'm not a racist. Yes, I'm for justice. But actions speak louder than words. So even though they may agree, you know, that what you said about justice is correct.
So your question is?
How do you really solve the problem? If this is the number
by
one problem on the planet.
Just what I just said. But wait a minute. I'm going to answer the question.
Okay.
You answer the question by changing the words that you use, because a lot of what is done in the system of white supremacy is held together by the use of words.
Hold that thought right there, and Brother Neil Fuller Jr. And Gwen, stay with us, too, because we've got to take a break at the top of the hour and let you guys continue this very interesting discussion. 800-450-7876. You too can join the calls. We'll take the calls right after this short break. And thank you for staying with us, folks. I'm Neil Fuller Jr. discussing racism. And this book is called The Code. That's a short name for it. It's got everything you want to know on how to deal with racism. Remember to call to speak to Brother Neil Fuller Jr. It's 800-450-7876. Before the break, Dr. Fuller was explaining to Gwen her question. Neely Fuller Jr., you can continue.
Yes. Hello.
Yes, Dr. Fuller?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I'm so confused. Okay, you say you solve the problem by changing the words that you use.
Yes, ma'am.
I need you to explain that a little bit more. I mean, just by changing the words solves the problem?
Well,
racism?
Every problem only in getting a car repaired, I think one of the first things that has to happen, because I've been in a car repair shop, regrettably, too many times, and one thing that they start with asking questions.
Right.
They want to know, how does your car act? What is it doing? Does it have a flat tire, or do you have an engine problem? And sometimes my answer is, I don't really know what the problem is, except the car won't start. Okay, we're getting somewhere right now. I'm using words. I'm saying the car won't start. I put the key in the ignition, and the car won't start when I turn the key. I've been told that when I turn the key, and the key is in the ignition, and I turn the key, the car is supposed to start. But if I tell the mechanic that the car won't start when I do that, then the mechanic has something to go on, because the mechanic has communicated with me. We use words. The car is still the car. It's sitting there. The car doesn't care one way or another.
Okay.
The car's not saying anything.
Okay, I understand that example.
It's the same way when you deal with people in solving any other problem. But you have to choose your words. Otherwise, nothing is going to get done. You can't start talking about mountains when you're trying to get your car repaired. Otherwise, your car is not going to get repaired because you're not talking about the subject that you're talking about.
Okay, let me go back to Dr. Frances Kress Welsing. I know she's very familiar with all of this, She's a very intelligent, very astute, well-read, well-studied, well-researched, you know, she's well-renowned. She has a problem.
Yes.
Stemming from racism with her house. I'm pretty sure she knows the words to use. And I'm pretty sure she has used those words. If you say, if I'm following your logic, if you say by using or changing the words that you use solves the problem, then why is not her problem solved?
That's an excellent way to look at it, and you're correct. It means we're not using enough words and not enough people are using the same words to solve the problem. Sometimes it takes a quantum number of people to get it done. Like Martin Luther King used words, but he had a large number of people using the same words. And then people start paying attention. It's just like, you know, if you're down at the bottom of the well and you're shouting and whatnot, and, you know, and you, everybody that you're shouting at, trying to get out of there, seems to be far distant from where they can hear you. Nobody actually hears you, or people hear something, but they don't know what it is, or they're not paying much attention to it, or they don't think that there's a real problem there. Then the result is you will die at the bottom of that well. Now, since you use the scenario of dislocation, meaning forcing black people to move from one place to another, under the system of racism, they have to do this.
Who has to do it?
I'm going to tell you right now. A lady asked me some years ago in Ohio. She said, you know, I was sitting there at her breakfast table because I was in Ohio to make a talk out of the book on the code because this is what I do.
Mm-hmm.
So she said, well, what does your code say? Or what does the code say, or whatever this is that you got, about my neighborhood? She said, this is a very, very nice neighborhood. I moved here. I bought a nice house here. You can see it's a nice neighborhood. But I hear rumors that the white people, I said, and so I corrected her. I said, not just any white people. I say the white supremacists are going to make you move. And she said, yes. I hear rumors that they're going to make me do that. So what does your code say about that? I said, prepare to move. And she said, what? I said, prepare to move. I said, because there are some things that they are going to do, regardless of what anybody says, because they got the muscle.
Okay, now see.
And I said, and this is one of them. It's called racial dislocation. They do it every day all over the world. And they are going to start doing more of it. Wherever black people are, wherever, if you're comfortable and you think you should have found you a space on this planet where you're comfortable and that you are going to stay there, and they happen to notice that you are comfortable in the space that you're in, they are going to come down the road and say, you know what, you're a little bit too comfortable, which means when you get comfortable, you might get an idea of thinking about other things, like solving other problems, because you have solved this problem, so I'm going to give you this problem again. And I'm going to keep giving you this problem, because I have found out scientifically that when you keep people on the move, make wanderers out of them, send them scattered here and there and hither and yon, you can always control them.
Okay. Can I stop you for a second, please?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Like I said, I'm trying to follow your logic, but I have to be honest, it sounds like your logic is a little flawed in some areas. Okay, let's go back to the Dr. King scenario. And you were saying because he had a large number of people listening to him, if he had a large group of people listening to him, and could you explain that again?
Well, for one thing, there were signs all over the place saying black people couldn't stop here, black people couldn't stop there. I know. I came through that era. I was wearing a uniform, just got back from the front. And I'm in uniform, and I couldn't stop and get a sandwich. And I didn't know what to do about it except to die by going into the restaurant and saying, I'm not going to leave, in which they would have promptly shot me, uniform and all, at that particular time, and nothing would have been done about it. Why? Because I didn't have enough people who would say anything about it. And I knew that. So I just stayed on the bus and was hungry while the white soldiers got off the bus and went in the restaurant and ate and came back, and I sat there unfed.
Okay. All right.
That's the way that works. See, you have to have enough people who will listen to you, and eventually you have to have enough white people who will listen to you.
Okay. Okay. Wait a minute. Okay. Let's go back to Dr. King again. This man started a mass movement. He was recognized. People were listening to him.
Yes.
Not only in this country, all over the world.
Yes.
Okay. He drew attention from all over the world regarding the racism in America pertaining to black people in particular, right?
Yes.
So he had a large group of people listening to him. So just because you have a large group of people listening to him or listening to someone, it still doesn't change the problem. It doesn't solve the problem. We still have the problem.
Oh, you mean the problem of racism?
Yes.
Yes, we win some battles. And I always use the formula of 3 steps forward, 2 steps back, because that's how I measure what black people do. We make about 3 steps forward and 2 steps back. We're still in a battle. We have battles all day. We have battles on jobs. We have battles trying to get a job. We have battles just trying to get from one place to another. Transportation problems, all kinds of problems. We have battles with each other all the time. You can't step out your door without a black person trying to do some harm to you. I mean, somewhere, if you walk enough blocks, it's going to be some black person waiting on one of those blocks to do you some kind of harm, even if it's no more than snatch your purse.
Okay.
That's a part of the problem.
I'm sorry. So, can I stop you again, please?
Yes,
okay.
Ma'am.
You gave another scenario about a lady who shared with you that she had to move away from her home because of racism.
Yes. No, she didn't have to move. Fortunately, I checked later on, and I said, what happened to the lady who said she might have to move?
Uh-huh.
Well, apparently the white supremacists, because I say they made the decision, decided that they weren't going to bother them at that time.
All right, hang on a second, guys, because we got to take another break. Folks, yes. Speaking with Gwen, speaking with Neely Fuller Jr., and hopefully we'll wrap it up when we come back. Some other folks want to talk to him as well. 800-450-7876, number to call. Speak to Neely Fuller Jr. We're taking calls after this short break. And thank you for staying with us, folks. Dr. Neely Fuller Jr. is our guest. And Gwen, if you can wrap it up, we've got some other folks.
Well, I'll just end by saying that I'm still confused because following your logic, if you solve all problems just by changing the words that you use, then we still have the problem. We still have the problem. So maybe you can explain that a little bit more. Maybe I'm just not really understanding. And Carl, thank you so much for taking my call. And Dr. Fuller, thank you. Thank you so much. All right.
Thank you for calling. And I am not supposed to be contributing to confusion, but I do want to say that when people go on the radio, we're on radio right now. When people write books, whether it's Uncle Tom's Cabin or something by some of the writers of old, they have a book called The Holy Bible. I mean, they have a book called The Holy Quran. These are words. Words do matter. History has shown that words matter. People have sometimes, I mean, whole armies have gotten on the move based on words, based on some general standing up saying something to the soldiers. And they do things that they wouldn't ordinarily do. This has happened all down through history. So I want people to understand that. If once we just lose control of words, just say, well, words don't matter and words don't do anything, so we might as well just be silent. That's the alternative. Just be silent and don't say anything. Then history has shown that usually when that happens, nothing happens except the person who is doing the talking, the person who hasn't given up on words and still says something, that's the person that is listened to, because that's the only person that's talking. And everybody else is just listening. Next thing you know, everything is going that person's way. So words are very important. I want to get this out to the radio audience. If we give up on the use of words, we're going to lose it all. Because the white supremacists, like the people who are called Indians sometimes, said, hey, just a few of them can come around. And a lot of them had a lot of words. And it didn't look like anything mattered for a while. But they spoke, and they spoke, and they spoke. And they spoke with forked tongue, meaning they'd say one thing and do another. But based on what they would say, they'd get a lot done. And one of the main things that they would do is get people going their way, get people to see things in a different way from the way that they had seen it before. And then the people were motivated to do the will of the people who were doing the talking. And there's a long track record of the world being motivated this way through words. So now what the lady is saying, she's confused, she said, so she doesn't see how words matter. But maybe we need to think about both of the things, because I always tell people, don't believe anything that I say. But just look at everything that everybody is saying, including the lady that just called. Now, she said she's confused about this thing by people being motivated by words. And maybe everybody could be confused, and people apparently are confused. Apparently she's confused by the things that I'm saying. And I certainly don't want to contribute to the confusion. But there are people who can say things in such a way that people are not confused. So maybe she can listen to them. But I certainly wouldn't give up on the use of words as being a motivating factor in getting people to do things that they haven't done before. Football coaches know about that type of thing. Otherwise, they wouldn't be football coaches. If they just sat there and looked at the game, as spectators, I mean, you know, anybody can do that. Sit there and look at the game. A cat can sit there and look at the game. So it evidently, a football coach says something. A football coach may not move around very much. He may be overweight so that he can't move around. Bad legs. He might even be in a wheelchair. But what he says may make a difference in what happens on that field. And it's true of teachers. Teachers use words. What is a teacher doing when a teacher is standing up in front of a class? What's the difference between one teacher and another? Sometimes the difference is how one teacher uses words and how the other teacher uses words. And one teacher actually teaches in such a way that people are motivated to do certain things a certain way and are very efficient in changing the entire world. And the other teacher absolutely does nothing because of the words that he or she is using and not communicating in a way that is causing people to do the things that are said needs to be done. So we don't want to give up on words, otherwise we'd have to shut down all radio, all communications, and say words don't matter. Words don't matter. Because words, in my opinion, motivate people to get things done the way that the things are going to be done. The white supremacists understand this. They are the masters of words. And this is why they are the masters of people. Just a handful of them can come in and just by using words cause all sorts of things to happen that a lot of people refer to as being miracles. So we need to examine that.
Let's take another call, Dr. Fuller. 800-450-7876. Go to Michael on line two. Michael's in Pittsburgh. Michael, you're on with Neely Fuller, Jr.
Thank you. And thanks, Mr. Fuller. I want to address the lady that was confused. My thing is that these people for centuries have been the masters of confusion, lies, and death. And until we decide to address them with a new truth and justice with our own words, asking them why do they impose upon us death, lies, and confusion. The other thing is religion. their schools of institutions of learning, their economics. And until we pull away from this, we'll always be trapped in it. We have to overcome our fears silently and understand what we've been living in for centuries. And until we decide to pull away and ask those small pockets of racist people, why are you opposing upon us, selling us water that God gave to all of us? You give to those who sing, dance, or jump, or entertain you. We know that racism works for some blacks. It does. They allow that to happen because it's a part of the confusion. So some blacks say, oh, it doesn't bother me. It's okay. Meanwhile, millions of us suffer. Like he said, until we take those who are less fortunate than us, we must go to the bottom and pull them up. This world was put here for all of us. Not for.
All right, Michael, can you put it in a question form so he can respond? Because we've got some other folks who want to talk to him as well.
Yes, I just wanted to address the girl that had called with the confusion. Mr. Fuller, my thing is to ask you a question is until we decide or when we decide to pull away and then start our own language that speaks upon justice, how do we come about this? Through the churches, because they did it through the missionaries, because we were spiritual people. How do we unwind? Do we totally walk away?
Oh, we have a code. The white supremacists have a code. That's my answer. That's why I've tried to have a counter code, meaning a code of what? Thought, speech, and action. See, the lady was correct, I think. If what she was saying was just words alone won't do it. No, words cause people to act. But people have to act on the words that are being said. Now, I have asked black people using words to not celebrate anything, ever, until this problem is solved, called racism. That's a big thing to ask black people to do. I mean, that's over the top. I mean, that brings about instant pain, because black people like to celebrate every 5 minutes worldwide. We find any excuse to celebrate. And this has worked against us. We should not be a celebratory people. We are not qualified. Get something to celebrate first, then celebrate. You even have some football players, and I've seen some of them do it, and I've heard of others, black football players, who run down the field and throw the ball down before they get to the end zone because they're so intent on celebrating.
All right, hold that thought right there, Dr. Fuller, because we've got to take a break. Michael, thanks for your call. 800-450-7876. We'll come back. We'll talk about celebrations and why you say the black folks shouldn't celebrate. Take your phone calls for Neely Fuller Jr., folks, right after this quick break. And thank you for staying with us, folks. And you got to listen very, very clearly to what Dr. Neely Fuller Jr. is saying. His book is called The Code. That's the short word. You can Google it and you get the full title of the book. And before he goes, I'll allow him to tell you the full title and how you can pick up a copy of his book. But before the break, you were telling us that we shouldn't celebrate. Can you explain that for us again?
Black people shouldn't celebrate. They should meditate. You know, all these days that are set aside for all of this celebration, balloons and all that type of thing, no. Dancing and shaking and going on and whatnot, no. I know it's a tradition, but we should examine traditions. Traditions are supposed to do something, like improve your conditions. Black people's conditions all over the world are absolutely awful, and all the celebrations haven't helped. All it did was just put aspirin, or you might say put a Band-Aid temporarily, just almost like a drug, like cocaine. It just hides the problem. We're not qualified to celebrate. That's right in your face. I underline the word qualified. What qualifies people to celebrate when they have something to celebrate? Well, black people haven't qualified to celebrate. We should put that burden on ourselves by our own evaluation. I'm not talking about waiting on somebody else to evaluate us. We should evaluate our performance against what? Against all the problems that we have. And we should come up after that evaluation and say in one voice, you know what? We're not qualified to celebrate anything. Look at our condition. Look at our neighborhoods. Look at our schools. look at our the long lines, I mean, of unemployed people, and we are celebrating? No, we haven't done the work yet that calls for a celebration, just like any football player will tell you. I mean, recently I heard some football players just this past weekend saying, hey, we got to do better. I mean, this is unacceptable. I mean, they were saying that. Now, we can understand that if we're talking about football, but we don't apply it to anything else. See, we don't have time to be, you know, singing and dancing and whatnot. This is not singing and dancing time. Sing and dance after we get the work done, which means after there's no more racism. That's a tall order. That's a tall order. No singing and dancing until there's no more racism. Suppose every black person on the planet said that in one voice. Just saying that would cause alarm among the white supremacists if we said it in a minute. Black people don't sing and dance. They don't celebrate anymore. And if they sing, they're singing what they call patriotic songs about justice and et cetera. They're not just singing just to be singing, just to make noise. They're no longer in the noise business. They don't go to concerts and say, everybody make some noise. It's almost like a standard slogan. No, we're not going to make noise. We're going to make music. And music is different from noise. Music causes people to think constructively. And we are going to be in a constructive mode from here on in, starting with right now. And we're not celebrating birthdays because we already had a birthday. And since then, we've been having slow death days. So let's get on some life days. And the way you do that is to produce a product called justice in a world that's crying out for it. Now, you can have fun doing it. A lot of black people bring it up to me all the time. Well, when do you have fun? You can have fun doing something constructive. Black people have been programmed to think that you have fun by falling down drunk and getting run over by a car. Now, that's fun. We got to get out of that type of thinking. Or lying somewhere in an alley with a needle in our arm in a heap of trash. That's fun. That's what we call fun. Why? Because the white supremacists said, this is some excellent fun for you people. And then they demonstrate some of it themselves to lead us into it. Anything that's non-constructive, that's what they said it should be reserved for black people calling fun. If it's got anything constructive about it, it's not supposed to be fun. It's supposed to be work. It's supposed to be drudgery. It's supposed to make you very unhappy. If it's anything constructive about it, it's supposed to make you unhappy. But something that's pure stupidity, something that's pure foolishness, something that's very wasteful, then that's what is supposed to be designated. Put a big sign on it. This is what you call black fun, something that is totally non-constructive, something that's not going to help anybody do anything that makes sense. But that's supposed to be fun for black people. And we have bought into it wholesale, worldwide. And all we have to do is just make up our minds to stop it, and it doesn't take practice. That's another thing. People say it takes a long time to get that way. No, you just make the decision today. And also, another big thing that I repeat over and over again, don't pick up that cell phone or that app or whatever and contact anybody unless you have something constructive to say. So black people will become some of the most silent people in the world because we are not used to constructive conversation. We're so used to what we call jive talking and just talking just to be heard. And they're standing in the middle of the sidewalk, getting attention, I mean, by, you know, talking as loud as we can. Want everybody to pay attention to us. And then when we get everybody's attention, we don't have anything constructive to say. And our record proves it. So we can just go silent and do some meditating and do some constructive thinking. The textbook workbook says thought, then speech, then action, and make every last one of them constructive. Black people shouldn't contact not a relative, not a distant friend, not a sorority member or fraternity member, unless you have something constructive to say or do. And since I just mentioned something about fraternities, this nonsense about hazing, I want to say something about it right now, now that I thought about it. How in the world did black people ever adopt anything like that? Anywhere. You're going to beat on somebody in order to be initiated, you say, into an organization? When black people have been beat on ever since there has been black people on the planet. Beat all across the Atlantic slave trade. Beat, 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 kunta kinte, over and over again. And then you go in a sophisticated university, you're going to say something about, well, we have to initiate you by taking you through some trials of being beat on and humiliated and treated like a dog. No, it should be just the opposite. You should welcome the person into the fraternity by showing them all the constructive things that you do and tell them to embrace all of that. That's if you're doing anything constructive in the first place. Otherwise, you don't have any business having a fraternity if you're not doing anything constructive, if you're just showing out. Enough of that. Black people don't have any license to show off. Nothing. Our record is not good enough to show off anything. Your house, your car, your jewelry, your talents, anything. You use them to try to produce a product called justice. Don't spend 5 minutes showing off anything, because most of what you get that you show off, and that's in the book, under one of the four show-offisms, you get it from the white supremacists anyway. So what are you showing off? Your ability to get something from them? The only reason you got it is because they let you have it. Otherwise, you wouldn't have it. So stop showing off the things that the white supremacists allow you to have. Don't spend 5 minutes buying anything just to show off. Look at what I got. Well, where did you get it? Who let you have it? Stop and think. Colored folks.
800-450-7876 to speak to Needy Fuller Jr. Let's go to line four. Sister Truth is joining us from Maryland. Sister Truth, you're on, you have a question for Needy Fuller Jr.?
Hello, Mr. Nelson. Thanks for taking my call. I just wanted to say I think that it's rare that I agree so much with somebody's philosophy, but to Mr. Fuller, I just want to say I'm really understanding. I know some people said they didn't understand what you were explaining, but I'm really understanding your points, and you're making just really, really great points as far as what you're describing. And I know some other people speak on this similar topics, and I tend not to agree with a lot, like some other people's philosophy who speak on this topic, but what you're saying seem to be focused less on colorism or reversing the current system that's in now, but more.
Actually, hang on a second, Sister Truth, because we got to take a break. I'll let you finish up with on the other side. You two can join the conversation, folks, at 800-450-7876 to speak to Needy Fuller Jr. Take your calls right after this quick break. And thank you for staying with us, folks. Of course, you can always reach us on Facebook and Twitter at CarlNelsonShow.com. Our guest is Needy Fuller Jr. We're speaking to Sister Truth. Sister Truth, can you wrap up your question for Dr. Fuller?
Okay. Yes, Mr. Fuller, I just wanted to say I see that what you're doing is more towards trying to actually not so much have justice for just one particular ethnic group, but just for everybody all over. And I just think that everything you're saying is really on point. And I don't really have a specific question, but I just heard you before, and every time I hear you, your everything, the things that you say is just so on point as far as what I would say, you know, really needs to happen as far as getting true justice throughout the entire world society. And I mean, I don't really have a specific question. I just wanted to chime in and say that because what I'm hearing is just, this is amazing. I mean, I've heard other guests on, you know, on your show, Mr. Nelson, but what Mr. Fuller is saying is just, there's so much truth to it. And if you could have like a once a week lesson in what you're saying or something, that would be great. But I'll just hang up and, you know, hear if you have a response. But I'm just listening. And I do actually want to know where I could, get more information about your works, about your material, books, and all of that. Thank you.
Yes, you can get the books by going to the computer, producejustice.com. That's producejustice.com. And what should come up on the screen is a brief description of the basic textbook, the textbook for victims of racism, and also a book that came out in 2010 called A Counter-Racist Word Guide. Now, I've been talking about words all during this program. Well, this is a book that shows you how to use words, how not to use words, what questions to ask when other people use words. Because to me, words are very important, and I hope that I'm not confusing people when I say that. Words, when you go to school, you are listening to words. When people go to church, many millions of black people, even in the advertisements I'm hearing on this program, they're talking about going to church. They're talking about various church services. Well, when you go in a church, what you mostly see in there is benches, and you see a podium. And at that podium, someone comes out and says words. And even in most churches, Baptist churches, you might say, Christian churches, particularly among black people, you have a group of people called a choir. And these people come out, and they just don't come out and just stand there and hum. They say words in the songs that they sing. And these words are supposed to cause people to think a certain way. And the way that they're trying to get people to think, according to what they're saying in the words of the songs, they call them hymns, a lot of them, a gospel among black people, they are trying to inspire you to do certain things, not just listen to the words like they are just a foreign language or something, but you listen to the words and the words cause you to think about doing things, and then the things that you do will make, presumably, people better people so that they make the world a better place. And this is what schools do. This is what radio programs, if they are constructive, are supposed to do. So somebody says. And so I have written a couple of books, and you can get them by putting in the computer, producejustice.com. And case in point, some of the words that I have in the book, like the word America. Black people and many other people use the word America sometimes to equate that with non-justice and or racism, when the word America has nothing to do with non-justice and racism, unless if you want it to mean that. But if you want it to mean justice, it will mean justice. The logical term or definition for the word America would be people who practice justice. That's the logical term. If you're talking about people who practice racism, then that would be the white supremacists. So why not call it that? Why mix it up with something else? Why mix the words white supremacy or racism up with other words? Mix it up with the word America or the word, any other words, really, when this is really what it means. White supremacy is racism. Racism is white supremacy. And keep it that way. That way you don't get confusion, because people are always explaining themselves. I mean, they'll say, well, America practices racism, without saying anything about who is America. Stop and think about what you're saying. You say America practices racism. Well, now, who is America? Where is his or her address? What this America that practices racism, I mean, do you know who it is that you're talking about? Can you say who it is you're talking about? And then finally, after 2 or 3 hours, a person will finally say, well, I'm talking about these white people who are mistreating black people. That's who I'm talking about. Well, why didn't you say that in the beginning? Why did you have to say America? That's too broad. It's too wild. You know, some people sing songs saying America is a mountain, a purple mountain, or it's a ocean majesty, and all of this type of thing. So different people got different ideas about what you're talking about, and that causes confusion, which is the first thing you want to get rid of. Now, I hope that I haven't contributed to the confusion in this two-hour program, which apparently I have, because one lady called in and said, over and over again, she's confused about this business of white supremacists, presumably, trying to make someone move out of a house, and nothing is being done about it. And she's confused about how words can help to bring about a change where a person doesn't have to move out of a house. But I'm saying it depends on how the words are used and by whom and when. And how many people are using certain words. But then, depending on the conditions, when we're in the system of white supremacy, I'm saying when it comes to people being forced to move, if you're black and you're on this planet, the white supremacists, if they want you to move, they will force you to move. I have found this out from experience over and over again, because that's something they have to be able to do in order to maintain white supremacy. They can't maintain white supremacy without forcing black people to move from one place to another periodically. That is an absolute must.
800-450-7876. Speak to Neely Fuller Jr., Ms. Richardson, and Chevy Chase. Ms. Richardson, can you make it real quick for us?
Am I on? Yes, I'll make it very brief, Carl. Good afternoon, Dr. Fuller.
Good afternoon.
And you are always exactly on the mark. And I'm saddened that people don't really understand, you know, the young lady earlier, even though I understood her concern, because I don't think she's really having the mindset of doing the real examining of it the way, you know, it takes sometimes years to where you had started, you and Dr. Welsing had started years ago. So it would take years of really examining it. The way I've examined it, the 20-some years I've listened to WOL, out of you two beautiful souls, you know. And you want people to know where the power base lies, and it's with white supremacy. You're right. And until we open our minds up and understand we have no power as people of color under that system, I'm saying we have power in numbers, yes. About 4 billion strong to there. I don't even think they even exist as a billion. So you know why they're afraid. I think if it was on the other arm or the other hand, I think we would be just as worrisome about it if we had the power the way that white people do. Because if black people maintain that kind of power, do you think they would relinquish it? And I'm going to say good evening with that, because I think it's going to lie wherever who has the power, whoever controls the world, they're going to stay dominant in their, as Dr. Fuller says, in how you understand right. How they are. All right. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you, Ms. Richardson. Neely Fuller Jr., real quickly, how can we get your book?
You can get the book by going to producejustice.com. That's producejustice.com. And a brief description will come up on your screen, and also a method for ordering.
All right.